finances for having organized this program in Chennai on this lessons and experience of the Kisan Long March in Maharashtra. At the outset, I pay tribute to the glorious legacy of the peasant struggles of Tamil Nadu and the working class struggles of Tamil Nadu, which are represented by legendary leaders like Comrade P. Ramamurthy and Comrade B. Srinivas Rao. Also by very outstanding women leaders like Comrade Manalur Maniam Munnai, Comrade K.P. Janki Ammal, whose centenary we celebrated last year, and the East Thanjavur struggle has always been written in letters of gold in the annals of farmer struggles all over India. I remember and I pay tribute to the martyrs of Kilvenmani, this massacre in 1968 shocked the entire country. And today, in 2018, we are having in a different way another massacre in Tamil Nadu. The 13 people killed in Thuthukudi just a few weeks ago, who were fighting against the Sterlite copper plant, its pollution, and the Sterlite being managed by Vedanta, a multinational corporation. I pay homage to the memory of the martyrs of Thuthukudi, and I support the people of Tamil Nadu in their valiant struggle against the Sterlite copper plant. My friends and comrades, first of all, I want to very gratefully thank all of you for having extended your tremendous support to the Kisan Long March in Maharashtra. And through you, I want to thank all the people of Tamil Nadu who actually supported this march. Many of you sent us messages, sent us on Facebook, all of you from so many places in Tamil Nadu and actually all over the country, we got congratulatory messages on this long march. Actually, this Kisan Long March in Maharashtra was part of the rising farmer struggles all over the country. Struggles in Rajasthan, struggles in Karnataka, struggles in Tamil Nadu itself, Andhra, Telangana, Himachal Pradesh, big rallies in Delhi. This is all actually a very big rising force of the farmers' movements all over the country. Why are all these things happening? That is the crux that we want to understand. Right in the beginning, I will give you only two facts which will draw your attention to this extremely serious agrarian crisis in the country. Actually, it is now not just limited to an agrarian crisis. As the renowned journalist P. Sainath, whom all of you know, he has written, it is now no longer an agrarian crisis, it has now become a civilizational crisis, a crisis of society as a whole. And how is it reflected? It is reflected in two facts. Number one, in the last 25 years of neoliberal policies, more than 4 lakh farmers have been forced to commit suicide in our country due to indebtedness. 4 lakh farmers having committed suicide due to indebtedness only in the last 25 years of neoliberal policies. Before that, none of us had heard about farmers hanging themselves or eating endrin and finishing their lives. We had never heard earlier in India at any point of time, but it has happened in the last 25 years with the neoliberal policies. Second point, which is not so much highlighted, but it requires to be highlighted as much as the peasant suicides in the country, and that point is every year in our country, lakhs of children in the Adivasi areas, in the Dalit areas of our country are dying every year due to starvation and malnutrition. In several states in the country, every year we find lakhs of small boys and girls are dying every year because of starvation and malnutrition. These are the two major symptoms of this extremely serious agrarian crisis in India that is growing much more serious with every passing day, with every passing month, and with every passing year. Why are these struggles of the farmers breaking out all over the country? What was the reason for the Kisan Long March in Maharashtra, or the struggles in Rajasthan, or the struggles in Karnataka and many other states? Before coming to the experience of the Long March, very briefly, we should try to understand what are the roots of the agrarian crisis today. In 10 minutes, I will try to dwell on that and then come to the Kisan Long March. Before independence, there were two major demands of the peasant movement in India. The first demand was freedom from British rule. That was, of course, the first demand, not only of the peasant movement, but of the people all over India. The second demand was a very simple demand, and that demand was, all of you must have heard it at some time or the other, the second demand was land to the tiller. Land to the tiller, the one who actually tills the land must be the owner of the land. This demand was directed against the landlords. We know in India, in Tamil Nadu, in every other country, state, we have a situation where landlords were capturing most of the land and many of the farmers were working as tenants. And that is why land to the tiller was the second fundamental demand of the All India Kisan Sabha and of all the farmer organizations, whichever were there during that time. But what happened? What happened? After 1947, 15th August, the Congress government betrayed the promise made during the independence struggle. Land was not given to the tiller. Tenancy laws were made, sealing laws were made, but so many loopholes were put in it to see to it that land concentration in the hands of the landlords and the rich farmers remained intact. And that is the reason, first reason for the agrarian crisis. Can you imagine if lakhs and lakhs of landless farmers had got land at that time, they would have got purchasing power. They would have got money in their hands. With their own land, they could have made the developments, and with money in their hands, the industries in the cities would also have flourished. The entire Indian economy would have seen a totally different picture than what is there today. But this was not to be. The Congress governments did not give land to the tiller. Land remained in the hands of the landlords and the rural rich, and that is the first cause for the agrarian crisis, which has today severely increased in the last few years. Very massive struggles were led in the 1940s by the All India Kisan Sabha on the land issue against the landlords. The climax, as all of you know, was the glorious Telangana peasant armed struggle led by Comrade P. Sundaraya. Other very important struggles, the struggle in East Thanjavur in Tamil Nadu, which I have referred, the struggle of Tebhaga in Bengal, the struggle of Punnapura Vailar and North Malabar in Kerala, Surma Valley in Assam, Ganapa Mukti Parishad tribal struggle in Tripura, and the Warli Adivasi revolt in Maharashtra led by Comrade Shamrao and Comrade Godavari Parulekar. These were all struggles against feudalism, against landlordism and for land. And that is why it is not an accident that after independence, the only three state governments, when they came to power, carried out land reforms, implemented the slogan of land to the tiller, were the three left-led governments of Kerala, West Bengal and Tripura. It was only in these three states that land was actually distributed to the tiller free of cost. One more state where it happened for different historical reasons, and that is the state of Jammu and Kashmir. That is for different historical reasons. And therefore we see all over the rest of the country, these land reforms were never carried out. And as a result, this created a tremendous kind of crisis, which we saw in the 1960s. Older comrades may be remembering, food self-sufficiency of the country was hit. And India, a huge country, had to depend on the United States of America to import PL-480 wheat from America in the 1960s. Red wheat, which America used to give to its cattle, that we were buying for our people. Because we did not have wheat, we did not have rice. This was the situation that was created in the 1960s. After that, the Green Revolution came, which all of you know. And this Green Revolution, certainly with its hybrid seeds, with its chemical fertilizers, with insecticides, this created definitely self-sufficiency in the country. That was a good thing. But at the same time, the Green Revolution was limited to only the irrigated areas of India. Only the irrigated areas. Punjab, Haryana, Western Uttar Pradesh, your delta part of Tamil Nadu, coastal Andhra Pradesh, western Maharashtra, only certain areas could experience the Green Revolution. Maximum number of the dry land areas, rain-fed agriculture, the Green Revolution could not take off. And as a result, what happened? Two kinds of inequalities increased in the country. Number one, regional inequality between the irrigated areas and the dry land areas. Tremendous number of the inequality increased. Even in the Green Revolution areas, a different kind of inequality increased, and that was class inequality between the rural rich and the rural poor. These two inequalities were also increased as a result of the Green Revolution. Comrades, this path also came into crisis by the late 1980s. And then in 1991, the neoliberal policies in our country began. It is not an accident that 1991 was also the year in which socialism in the Soviet Union collapsed. The same year, under Narasimha Rao government, in which Manmohan Singh was the finance minister, the neoliberal policies in India began, which were under the dictates of US imperialism. Same year, you see, it's not an accident. The same year, Soviet Union collapses. The same year, neoliberal policies in India begin. And what were the dreams that they peddled before us? I remember in Maharashtra, in many parts of the country, all these people, all these leaders of political parties, Congress, BJP, all many other farmers' organizations were also there supporting the neoliberal policies. And they said these neoliberal policies will lead to tremendous progress for farmers. What did they promise? I will tell you what they promised. They used to say, old comrades, older comrades will remember, they used to say, for example, this closed economy which was there before 1991 has had very bad effects. A farmer in Tamil Nadu does not get proper price for his crops in Chennai, does not get proper price in Madurai, does not get proper price in Coimbatore, does not get in Virudhunagar. All this they used to say. Now they say, with this open economy, free economy, now farmers from Tamil Nadu, farmers from Maharashtra, farmers from all over the country, now you will be able to export your crops directly to the markets of London, to the markets of Paris, to the markets of New York. This is what they promised us in 91, 92, 93, 94. Such speeches were made. Friends, I go all over the country for Kisan Sabha work and I ask the question, is there even one fortunate farmer among you in the last 25 years whose crop has you have exported to London, Paris and New York? Please raise your hands. And you will be surprised. Up to now, thousands of farmers I have addressed, not a single farmer has raised his hand that my crop I could export to London and Paris and New York markets. That is the reality. What has happened on the contrary? Crops and agricultural produce from New York, from Paris, from London, from Mozambique, from Africa, from Canada has started flooding into India, and as a result, the price that the farmer in India is getting for his crops has come down. Reverse has happened. Our agricultural produce has not been exported. Ulta, imports have come from there to our country and our farmers are being finished. That is the end result of the neoliberal policies. You may be knowing, Mozambique, Tur Dal was imported by the Modi government just now. Lakhs of tons of Tur Dal. The Tur Dal growers in India were finished. Sugarcane. You have a very big crop of sugarcane in Tamil Nadu. You are not getting proper price. Why? Because Mr. Narendra Modi, who gives all kinds of bad words to Pakistan day and night, today is importing sugar from Pakistan, and that is why the farmers of Tamil Nadu are not getting proper price for their sugar cane. This is neoliberalism with a vengeance. I will come directly to the Kisan Long March in Maharashtra. What were the demands? What were we fighting for?